We're the History Detectives, and we're going to investigate some untold stories from America's past. This week, we go to the front lines of the battle to end slavery. Does this cryptic letter reveal Lincoln's secret strategy for winning political power?
Did this faded map once guide slaves to freedom on the Underground Railroad?
And an encore presentation. Are these fragments from a deadly kamikaze attack that almost sank one of the Navy's most powerful warships?
Watch them, the detectives. Get so angry when the teardrops start. But you can't be wounded because you've got no hearts. Watch them, the detectives. It's just like watching the detectives.
This program was made possible by contributions to local PBS stations by viewers like you. Thank you.
Our first story examines a curious note that may have been signed by Abraham Lincoln. It's August 1858, almost 4 years before the Civil War. The national spotlight is on a key Senate race in Illinois, where a powerful and pro-slavery Democrat, Stephen Douglas, is being challenged for his seat by an undistinguished Republican, 49-year-old Abraham Lincoln. Lincoln's battle with Douglas that summer will determine the course of his career and ultimately the fate of the nation. Now, a firefighter from Tampa, Florida, has made what may be an astonishing discovery. A cryptic letter dating to that summer of 1858 with what appears to be the signature of Abe Lincoln. I'm Elise Luray, and I've come to meet Joe Skanks to find out more about the letter he found in his hometown.
Hi, Joe. I'm Elise.
Hi, nice to meet you. Come on in.
Thanks. So you found this, what, at a flea market?
Actually, no, I found it at a yard sale. I really like the old photos, and I bought a stack of them and brought them home.
Oh, these are nice.
Yeah, aren't they? I started shuffling through them to see what I had bought, and I found this. It's a letter, and it's signed by A. Lincoln.
And how'd you feel when you saw A. Lincoln?
I heard of people finding things in collections and so on, but I never dreamed I would find something like this.
The A. Lincoln on Joe's letter appears to be writing in response to an earlier letter to someone named Whitney.
It says, August 2nd, 1858, Springfield. Dear Whitney, yours of the 31st is just received. I shall write to B.C. Cook at Ottawa and to Lovejoy himself as to the subject you suggested. Pardon me for not writing a longer letter, as I have a great many letters to write. Your friend as ever, A. Lincoln.
So what exactly can I find out for you?
If the letter is authentic and what it's about.
Okay, well, if it is a real Abraham Lincoln letter, that's quite an extraordinary find. Probability of you finding a real Lincoln letter in a stack of photographs in Florida. Not so sure about it, but I'll see what I can do. I'm going to have to take it with me.
Okay, but be careful with it.
I will.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
The letter is so short, it's hard to figure out what it's about.
I've seen paper from the mid-1800s, and the paper looks period, so that's a good thing. There are some condition problems, which helps me date it. It bothers me that there's two dates, and one of them is in completely different ink than the other. And when I look closely at the lettering, it's so strange because some of it is in brown ink and some of it is in black and brown ink. It just doesn't look right to me.
I need to get a second opinion on this. But in the meantime, I want to see if I can figure out what might have been on Lincoln's mind that summer.
I want to find out specifically what's happening in August 1858, who the letter's to, and more about the content.
Lincoln is running for the Senate seat of Stephen Douglas, the powerful Democrat who pushed the controversial Kansas-Nebraska Act through Congress 4 years earlier. The law gave voters the right to choose whether the new territories of Nebraska and Kansas would permit slavery. The legislation sparked violence in Kansas. It also led to the formation of the Republican Party. It seems that the Whitney that Lincoln is writing to is Henry Whitney, a conservative Republican.
All right, I know that Lincoln's a Republican, and it says here that he was running for U.S. Senate against incumbent Democrat Stephen Douglas. He's writing to Henry Clay Whitney, who's a fellow Republican and is advising Lincoln on the Senate race.
This is interesting. One of the people Lincoln refers to in the letter, Owen Lovejoy, is a radical Republican known for his opposition to slavery.
It says he was an outspoken abolitionist considered too polarizing by political moderates.
But I'm still not clear why Lincoln is writing to Whitney or what the letter means. I'm meeting with Illinois state historian Tom Schwartz.
Come this way.
Okay.
Well, you have to understand that.
He says our letter has long been known to historians, but that the original is believed lost. Lincoln is writing in response to a warning he has received from Henry Whitney about the dangers for the Republican Party if Lincoln gets too close to the abolitionist Owen Lovejoy.
Well, Whitney was a lawyer like Lincoln, and more conservative views. So Whitney saw Lovejoy as not only a threat to carrying forward Republican victories, but ultimately as perhaps even an element that should be excluded from the Republican Party.
Tom shows me the original letter Whitney had written to Lincoln. In it, Whitney warns that the influence of the abolitionist is so feared by many in his own party, some Republicans are plotting to throw the election to Lincoln's Democratic opponent.
Whitney's warning Lincoln of the plot within the Republican Party that there were Republicans who disliked Lovejoy, also disliked Lincoln, and were willing to give this election to Douglas.
But why would some Republicans sabotage their own candidate? Tom says the new party was facing a very old issue. Illinois borders the South, and many voters were simply not ready for an abolitionist message.
And that term abolitionist was frequently had the undercurrent of racism. You know, if we abolish these slaves, they're going to move next door to you. Feeding that irrational fear that blacks were somehow non-human and a threat to white supremacy.
Our letter suggests that Lincoln appreciates how associating publicly with the firebrand Lovejoy might actually set back the cause of freedom.
I think he shared Whitney's concern that it could do damage in the short run. This fragile Republican coalition of all these disparate groups could be undone if it was seen as representing the most extreme views of the party.
Our letter clearly deals with a crucial moment in Lincoln's career, but is it authentic?
Hi, John.
Hi.
I'm Elise.
I'm meeting with Lincoln expert John Lupton at the Illinois Historic Old State Capitol building.
Yeah, there's a lot of Lincoln history in this building.
John is also familiar with our letter and says it must be considered in light of Lincoln's historic House Divided speech. It was delivered in this building as he accepted the party's nomination to run against Douglas. A house divided against itself cannot stand. I believe this government cannot endure permanently half slave and half free. John says Lincoln's public opposition to slavery, delivered 2 months before our letter was written, created a sensation.
The conservatives were not too fond of it because they were afraid that Lincoln was maybe leaning too far to the abolitionist side. And of course, the abolitionist side very much loved it.
But even some of Lincoln's supporters thought the speech too radical. And he spent much of the summer attempting to persuade the party that he was the right man to lead them. That's the subtext of our letter.
Why is it so cryptic?
Well, he was being a little bit guarded because he was trying to balance the different factions of the party. He was really just trying to stay in the middle of all of it.
He was the ultimate politician?
Absolutely. Lincoln is an excellent politician. He's really navigating these political waters quite well.
John's taking me to the Lincoln Library Conservation Lab. He's thrilled at the possibility Joe has stumbled upon a lost piece of Lincoln history.
Okay, John. Here it is.
Okay.
What do you think?
The two-tone ink that I noticed in my evaluation is also bothering John, but most of the handwriting seems familiar.
It's definitely distinctive of Lincoln's handwriting, the way he crosses his T's, the way he signs his name.
Well, that's good.
The handwriting looks very good.
Why would the date appear twice on the document?
Someone may have just written in there just to show what the date actually was, because where the tear is, that's where the second would have been. I was able to look at the documents.
Under the microscope, the mystery deepens.
You can definitely see some traces of iron gall ink, which was commonly used by Lincoln and, you know, many of his contemporaries. You can tell by the way it fades into the paper and just the way it ages over time.
So the ink is period to the piece?
The ink is period to Abraham Lincoln's time.
But it seems the writing has been tampered with. Someone has scrawled over the letter.
Now, if you look at the next number, the 5, you can see that there's something on top of the 5, like this big, heavy black ink. It's not contemporary to the time period. The entire letter is that way. Mm. There's this black ink written over everything.
Why would somebody trace over it?
John thinks he knows the answer. Long after the Civil War, Whitney had published copies of his correspondence with Lincoln. But the copy he published had long troubled historians.
The handwriting is just a little bit shaky in the facsimile. It wasn't quite as fluid as how Lincoln normally writes.
It seems the suspicious copy was simply the result of the technique Whitney had used to make it. First highlighting our letter, then tracing it.
Here's Lincoln's signature. If you look at this A, you'll notice that the overwrite in the heavy black ink goes straight up and down, which is what it looks like in the facsimile. But if you look at the monitor, you can see a curlicue in there.
So what does that mean?
That means underneath all of this black ink is Lincoln's original handwriting. So we have an original Lincoln document here.
Joe's going to be thrilled. But I'm still not entirely clear on how Lincoln dealt with the alleged Republican plot against him. Did he distance himself from the abolitionist Owen Lovejoy, as his letter perhaps suggests? I'm hoping Lovejoy scholar Bill Moore can help.
Bill Moore, come on in.
Thank you.
He explains how by that summer of 1858, Owen Lovejoy was one of the most committed anti-slavery politicians in the country.
Owen makes a speech about seeing slaves on an auction block. And he says, can you hear the auctioneer now? Hear him saying, man for sale, man for sale. And he says, who allows this little white man to be able to put these strong black men and women for sale? And then he points out, he says, we have all done that. We, who are voters, who vote for our congressmen, because congressmen made them slaves and we can unmake them.
But as he ran for the Senate, Lincoln saw his fellow Republicans' public passion as a liability. Lincoln was against slavery, but he was not an abolitionist. Our letter illustrates how Lincoln worked to assure conservatives he could lead the party and hold Lovejoy at an arm's distance.
Lincoln had to distance himself from Owen Lovejoy publicly.
Privately, however, it was a different matter.
By 1858, Abraham Lincoln and Lovejoy are a political team. Lovejoy working openly for Lincoln, but Lincoln working behind the scenes.
What Bill shows me next allows me a unique look into the guile and character of a future president. I tell Joe, his document is at the heart of one of our most conflicted moments in history and is indeed an authentic Lincoln letter.
Congratulations, it's quite a find.
I have those chills that I got when I first saw it.
In Joe's letter, Lincoln is leaving the impression he will distance himself from Lovejoy and promise to write to him. That letter does not survive. But Bill Moore shows me Owen Lovejoy's response to Lincoln, written just days later.
He ends the letter, yours for the ultimate extinction of slavery, Owen Lovejoy. And that refers to Abraham Lincoln's House Divided speech, in which he says, if we can put slavery and stop it in the territories, it will be in the course of ultimate extinction.
Bill says the intimacy of the Lovejoy letter and the tone of the final sentence makes clear that Abraham Lincoln and Owen Lovejoy shared a common purpose.
It was one of the great relationships of a political generation, of people who could trust one another, who could disagree with one another. Lincoln has to come around to ending slavery, and it was a hard thing for him to do, but Lovejoy had to come around in the beginning to just settle for stopping the spread of slavery. And they both work back and forth and behind the scenes.
So the paper that you picked up for $8 at a yard sale turns out to be a very important document in American history.
It's an amazing feeling.
It's real.
And I possess it.
Thank you so much.
In the weeks after our letter was written, Lincoln would debate Stephen Douglas with an eloquence that gained him national attention. Lincoln lost the Senate that year, but he won the popular vote. And he would go on to win a far bigger prize, his party's nomination for president. That nomination and Lincoln's fight against Douglas were the wins that carried him to the White House.
Democrats and Republicans long wrestled over the subject of race relations in the southern states.
Following the Civil War and the passage of the 15th Amendment, which granted suffrage to African American men, some Republicans hoped to control the levers of power in the South through their new base of voters.
But as the 19th century came to a close, many Southern Democrats backed Jim Crow legislation. Those laws denied African Americans the right to vote and helped Democrats solidify a grip on the Southern states that would take a century to loosen. Democrats were increasingly split on the issue of race. When presidential candidate Harry Truman pronounced his support of civil rights at the 1948 convention, 35 Southern delegates walked out. In 1964, Republican presidential candidate Barry Goldwater opposed the Civil Rights Act and became the first Republican to win electoral votes from the Deep South since Reconstruction. In 1968 and 72, Republican Richard Nixon used a so-called Southern strategy in his successful bids for the White House. Against a backdrop of anti-war protests and black unrest, Nixon used phrases like states' rights and law and order to appeal to white Southern voters. And today, the Republican Party routinely carries the South in local and national elections.
Our next story traces a map that may have led slaves to freedom. The horrors of slavery forced those in bondage to make the ultimate choice: to remain in shackles or to risk their lives by escaping. By the late 1700s, as more northern states passed emancipation laws, rewards for the return of fleeing slaves became a standard feature in American newspapers. Under the constant threat of capture, the terrified escapees will eventually find a possible source of help: a secret network of individuals who in the 1800s come to be known as the Underground Railroad. Almost 200 years later, Ann Zarella from Bradley Beach, New Jersey, has a strange map she suspects may be related to this clandestine escape network. I'm Gwendolyn Wright, and I'm meeting with Ann to take a look at what she found.
And here's the map.
Thank you. Well, I see here's the Ohio River in southern Ohio. Now, how did you come to find this map?
Well, my husband and I went to a garage sale in 1997. We bought the map for $45. It wasn't until I got it home and really looked at it that I noticed that it was unusual.
Now, where did you get the idea that this map was connected to the Underground Railroad?
Anne's done little research and has discovered that the area of her map, southern Ohio, was a hotbed of Underground Railroad activity in the middle of the 19th century. She's also noticed a series of odd markings on her map.
There are all these dotted lines, but none of them have a name. And I began to wonder what kind of a map it would be where you didn't name the roads, so you wouldn't be traveling on roads. You would be traveling in some secret way.
Let's look at the key. Those marked thus are meetings of friends.
Yes, and I'm assuming that these were Quaker settlements.
Well, the Quakers called themselves friends, and these must be their meeting houses,
right,
where they worshiped. There were a number of them, in fact, yes, in this area.
And, of course, the Quakers were related to the Underground Railroad. They they helped the escaped slaves.
Now, tell me exactly what you'd like for me to find out, Anne.
I would like to know if the map is authentic, if it really was used for the Underground Railroad, if some conductor on the Underground Railroad actually carried the map. I can see it was carried by someone.
Well, it'll be an interesting quest for me to see what I can find out. May I take it with me?
Please do.
Anne certainly has an intriguing map, but I'm not sure about her theory. I suspect not many roads in these rural areas had names back then. And it seems unlikely that a slave could have used a map like this. Most couldn't read. Anne thinks an Underground Railroad conductor, someone assisting escaping slaves, may have carried it. That's possible, but it seems a bit far-fetched.
If he or she were caught, an entire network of safe places and people who tried to help would be destroyed.
Here's the area we're looking at. Ohio, the Ohio River, Pennsylvania, and West Virginia. But there's no date or signature, so it's hard to know who made Anne's map or when.
We have very little material evidence from the Underground Railroad today. So if this map is what Anne thinks it is, it could be quite a significant find.
I have a hunch that the Quaker symbols on the map may be crucial to unlocking its meaning. So I'm emailing a scanned copy to Quaker historian Christopher Dinsmore. In the meantime, I'm meeting with Professor Blaine Hudson, who specializes in the history of the Underground Railroad.
Very nice to meet you.
Well, very nice to meet you as well.
He says the flight north for slave escapees was a terrifying odyssey.
Gwen, if you could imagine walking from, let's say, the northern part of Alabama or Georgia to Detroit, perhaps in the dead of winter, that's a long way to go. Fugitive slaves had to be physically strong, they had to be courageous. So these were exceptional people. And folks, of course, who got caught would be subjected to gruesome punishments. They'd probably be sold farther south. You knew that if you got caught, nothing good was going to happen.
Blaine reads from the testimony of Henry Bibb, who made a run for freedom in the winter of 1837.
I traveled on until I had arrived at the place where I was directed to call on an abolitionist, but I made no stop. So great were my fears of being pursued by the pro-slavery hunting dogs of the South. I prosecuted my journey vigorously for nearly 48 hours without food or rest, not knowing what moment I might be captured, pelted by the snowstorms, and not a house in which I could enter to shelter me from the storm.
That's a very powerful description of both fear and bravery. You said that Henry Bibb was writing this about an escape in 1837. Yeah. What are more or less the dates for the Underground Railroad?
Blaine explains how the Underground Railroad got its name from the parallel development of the American railroad system. People assisting slaves were conductors. Safe houses were called stations.
The Cotton Kingdom, increasing concentration of slaves in the Deep South, begins to stimulate a much heavier flow of fugitives. We estimate, for example, probably between 1810 and 1860, maybe about 130,000, 140,000 people escaped. Before that, maybe another 100,000 or more.
Even after the 1830s, however, not all escaping slaves had the help of an organized network.
The fact of the matter, based on the evidence that we see now, is that probably just one in three received some kind of assistance. The rest depended largely on their own courage and sometimes their own luck to escape from slavery.
Let me show you this map, and I'd like to know if you can tell me whether there was Underground Railroad activity in this area.
This is a fascinating map. Now, of course, in Virginia, you've got a very heavy slave population. You've got the mountains through which a number of fugitive slaves escaped. And then, of course, you've got the Ohio River, you know, which is the great border between slavery and freedom in this part of the country. That was a critical area for fugitive slaves to traverse. So
you have the symbols indicating meeting houses catch his eye, too.
Of all the religious denominations in North America, certainly, the Quakers were most consistently opposed to slavery and most open to actually aiding fugitive slaves. Now, this didn't mean every Quaker was going to be a friend of the fugitive. But so where you find Quakers, certainly in this border area, you typically will find some Underground Railroad activity.
Do you think this map or a map like this could have been part of the Underground Railroad?
There is no known instance of a map. The nature of the Underground Railroad was such that people didn't use maps, per se. Information passed from person to person. African Americans often got it from what they called a slave grapevine. But writing things down and marking things on a map, and this was all illegal, would not have been very wise.
And it could be dangerous if found.
That's right.
So.
So from that standpoint, if this is actually a map of an underground railroad network, it would be very unique.
I'm meeting map dealer Paul Cohen in New York City to find out if our map is authentic and when it was drawn.
Here's a map from 1808. Mm-hmm. It was done of Yellowstone Park, and it has a very similar look mm-hmm. to the map we have here. The writing is the same, the way the rivers are featured are the same. It's even folded in a similar way.
Paul believes Anne's map is authentic and thinks he can date it with a high degree of accuracy. Ohio was named as a state, which didn't happen until 1803. And while the town of Zanesville became the capital in 1810, on our map, it's little more than a village.
I think that Zanesville would have been given much more prominence on this map if it had been the state capital. So I think we can date this map between 1803 and 1810.
This was certainly a period when many escaping slaves were crossing into Ohio. But Paul's skeptical our map has much at all to do with slavery.
Do you see any evidence that this map might have been part of the Underground Railroad?
Well, whenever I look at a map, I wonder what the purpose was for the map maker. And he has stated his purpose right in the first line of the legend. It's to show the location of the meetings of friends. I don't see anything on this map to indicate that it was used for runaway slaves, other than the fact that the Quakers were sympathetic to their cause.
Our investigation seems to have hit something of a dead end. But an email from the Quaker historian Christopher Densmore suggests our document may have a mysterious twin.
Gwen, your map looks somewhat like this one, another manuscript map that we have here in our Quaker collection. So Chris Densmore has sent me a map. Let's see.
This map looks remarkably similar. The handwriting is different, but the style is the same. It's of the same region, and it shows Quaker meeting houses.
Oh, wait, there seems to be a name here. Horton Howard.
Someone named Horton Howard appears to have drawn the map. I wonder what I can find out about him.
Oh, here's something about a Horton Howard. Let's see. Howard lived in Short Creek, which I think is on the map. Yes, there it is. And he seems to have helped organize the first Ohio yearly meeting of friends in 1813. But there's nothing about any maps. Well, there is a collection of his letters. I'll print those out and see what I can find. Here's a letter from October 30th, 1818, in which Howard says that their yearly meeting of the Quakers is presenting a motion to Congress to abolish the slave trade. And he goes on to tell his friend, "I earnestly desire that thou may yield to the call, the loud call of this suffering people."
I'm pretty certain this is not an Underground Railroad map, but I'm curious. Why is this ardent abolitionist drawing a map that looks so much like Anne's?
Oh, this is beautiful.
I meet Chris Densmore at Swarthmore College, which was founded in 1864 as a Quaker school.
Now, I've pretty much ruled out this having anything to do with the Underground Railroad, but given Horton's connection, I'd like to know more about the activity of Quakers in this area.
Well, I think we've got quite a bit for you, so follow me and let's see what we can show you.
Chris explains how early Quaker opposition to slavery was rooted in the Christian ideal of doing unto others as you would have done to yourself. And he says our map is of an area where the roots of the abolitionist movement took their earliest hold.
Here is a philanthropist. This was probably the first specifically anti-slavery magazine to be published.
What year did it begin?
1817. And it's published in Mount Pleasant, Ohio.
Now, is that on this map? I don't recall
okay.
it.
Here's Short Creek. Mount Pleasant is just a little bit north of that. Mount Pleasant is where they built the yearly meeting house.
Right in the center of this area.
That's correct. That's the center of Quakerism in Ohio. And here's another publication. Benjamin Lundy from St. Clairsville. which is right here, began published in 1821, a publication called The Genius of Universal Emancipation.
So this area becomes one of the earliest and most concentrated centers of anti-slavery activity in the United States. Is that right?
Right. Right in the middle of the map. It influenced anti-slavery throughout the nation.
Why was there such a concentration of anti-slavery activity here?
Well, I have one more thing to show you. I have some other maps that look like yours.
Let's see. So these are remarkably similar. They're all showing the same area and the concentration of Quaker meeting houses. And here's H.H. again. Is that Horton Howard again?
That's almost undoubtedly Horton Howard.
So what are all these maps then?
What Chris tells me next gives me an answer for Anne and the true meaning of her map. I asked Anne to meet me in Mount Pleasant, Ohio. Well, Anne, unfortunately, there's no indication that your map was used for the Underground Railroad.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, I am disappointed.
But you were really onto something. Come inside, I'll show you.
Anne, this is the Mount Pleasant Meeting House, built on a site right in the center of your map, right there. It was built in 1814, several years after we think your map was made. And there's something very significant that your map shows us.
I tell Anne that Chris Dinsmore's collection of maps had told a story about a religious exodus from the South.
This wasn't a map that led slaves north, it was a map that led Quakers north.
In the late 1700s, slavery was becoming more entrenched in the plantation economy. And many Quakers abandoned the South, believing slavery an evil they could not live alongside. They came north to Ohio and needed maps as they settled in the area.
Quakers are involved in a migration of their own. And this would have been very useful for a friend in North Carolina to know where Quakers were, because they wanted to move to some place where they could attend meeting and where they would be among fellow Quakers.
My goodness, well, I'm proud. I am delighted. I thought it was old. I didn't think it was that old.
By migrating north, the Quakers who used her map had taken a powerful stand against slavery. And by writing and speaking out against its injustices, this community helped light a moral beacon that would guide the nation.
Just imagine this room filled with women and men deliberating among themselves, and many of them going on to take direct action to advance their common goal of greater equality for all people.
Well, I realize it's just a small part, but I'm happy that it does take a part of the movement. I think that's very impressive.
In a society of immigrants, it's the ebb and flow of great migrations that has shaped the modern face of our nation. Although the gold rush opened the floodgates to the Western expansion, the mass movement of Europeans into the interior began a century earlier. With a rifle and a Bible, the Scots-Irish ventured into the Appalachian wilderness, crossing a boundary between the old European social order and a pioneer life of frontier freedom. By 1800, approximately 400,000 European settlers had traveled west, searching out fertile farmland, many gaining squatters' rights in crudely built shelters. In the housing crisis of the early 20th century, those shelters had become cramped city apartments. That crisis was partly solved following World War II, when cheap land, cheap gasoline, and the mass construction of millions of single-family homes helped drive a mass migration to the suburbs. Yet, not all migrations are permanent. Recently, the great migration of African Americans northward has been reversed. Between 1995 and 2000, the South gained some 350,000 African American residents. In the last decade, thousands of college-educated blacks joined a thriving middle class, which gave the city of Atlanta the nickname the Harlem of the 90s.
In an encore broadcast, our story relives a deadly attack on one of the most famous battleships of the Second World War. It's March, 1945. The future of the Pacific War is shrouded in gun smoke and uncertainty.
The Japanese are fighting a desperate campaign to defend the island of Okinawa. If they lose the island, mainland Japan will become vulnerable to a U.S. invasion. They send hundreds of kamikaze planes to attack the American invasion fleet. Those planes are remarkably successful, wreaking havoc and scoring a direct hit on the heavy cruiser, the USS Indianapolis. Years later, a Cleveland area man has several items that may shed light on this key battle of World War II and tell him more about his uncle who served on the famous warship.
Since he died at sea, our family really has very little to remember him by, and so I'm just looking for more information to make the connection a little bit closer.
I'm Wes Cowan, and I'm on my way to meet Larry Klubert. The USS Indianapolis was one of our most famous warships. Its sinking in the final week of World War II by a Japanese submarine was the worst disaster in U.S. naval history. Nearly 900 men died. But I don't know much about the rest of the ship's service, so I'm very interested in hearing Larry's story. Well, Larry, what do you got for me?
Well, my aunt gave me these souvenirs from my uncle, who was in World War II.
Let's take a look at what you got here.
We have some Navy patches, metal fragment, an ID tag, and all these items came in a cigarette pack.
What can you tell me about your uncle?
My uncle's name was Arthur Michno, and here's this photo.
Boy, look how young he is. Larry tells me his uncle, like thousands of young men, was so eager to serve in the Navy that he lied about his age and enlisted when he was just 17.
Did your uncle survive the sinking?
No, he went down with the ship.
So, what do you want me to find out?
I want you to tell me if these came from a kamikaze attack on the Indianapolis.
Larry says that when his uncle came home on leave in April 1945, he talked about some sort of an attack that had occurred on the Indianapolis.
Well, I've been doing a little research and found out the ship came under a kamikaze attack.
When Arthur Michno went back to sea for the last time that July of 1945, his souvenirs remained at home, their origins a mystery. Do you mind if I take these things with me?
No, go right ahead.
This plaque with the Japanese characters on it, it's aluminum. One of the columns here has kilograms over centimeter squared. It's clearly been pried off of something. Now, these two patches both have an anchor on them, and I'm almost sure that these are sleeve patches from the Japanese Navy, and the chrysanthemum is the symbol of the Japanese emperor. This last thing, though, boy, this is really intriguing. This is just a chunk of super heavy metal. There's no recognizable shape. I have a feeling that this is going to be the toughest thing for me to figure out what it is. You know, the first thing I've got to do is do some basic research about the service record of the USS Indianapolis. In peacetime, the Indianapolis had been a Navy flagship, and following Pearl Harbor, she saw action throughout the Pacific campaign. In March of 1945, the heavy cruiser took her place in the largest invasion fleet in history. Off the coast of Okinawa, her guns lay down a devastating barrage on the heavily dug-in Japanese. But before the invasion is launched, the Japanese score a direct hit on the U.S. warship. It says here that on March 31st, the Indy had suffered a near-fatal kamikaze attack off the island of Okinawa. It looks as if Larry's research was accurate. The Indy was struck by a kamikaze. But the ship was about to experience much worse. Just 4 months later, after being repaired in California, she's assigned to a top-secret mission to the island of Tinian in the western Pacific Ocean. Unbeknownst to her crew, the Indianapolis is delivering components of the first operational atomic bomb. The Indy makes a 5,000-mile trip from San Francisco to Tinian in a record 10 days and delivers its mysterious cargo in perfect condition. Days later, while heading to the Philippines, the Indianapolis is struck by two torpedoes. She sinks in just minutes. By the time the crew is rescued nearly 5 days later,
only 1/4 of the men are still alive. There's a lot here about the sinking, but not much on the kamikaze attack. And Larry's story raises some questions, too.
How would somebody pick up these artifacts off of the deck of a flaming ship just seconds after a bomb had hit the deck?
I'm heading to Fredericksburg, Texas to meet with USS Indianapolis survivor L.D. Cox. He was just 19 years old when the ship sank, and he personally witnessed the kamikaze attack.
Wes Cowan.
Oh, hello, Wes.
He suggested we meet at the National Museum of the Pacific War.
LD, the investigation that I'm working on involves a second-class seaman. His name was Arthur Michno. You recognize him?
You know, believe it or not, I do.
You're kidding.
I recognize the man. I wasn't a close friend, but I remember seeing board ship.
That's amazing.
LD tells me about the terrifying night the submarine attacked.
I was on the bridge, just going on watch. And whoom, an explosion hit. We didn't know what it was. It was just out of the darkness of the night, these explosions.
With the India ablaze and taking on water, the captain gives the order to abandon ship.
How in the world did you get off the ship?
I went over the main deck, and I swam as fast as I could away from the ship because the suction will take you down. I turned and looked back. And the ship had already rolled on the starboard side, and men still jumping.
Within 12 minutes, the great ship sinks. In the darkness of night, hundreds of sailors plunge into the Philippine Sea. LD tells me that hours later, many began to hallucinate and suffer from dehydration. Not long afterwards, they noticed the sharks.
You could see dozens of them. You see the old fins in the water circling, and every now and then one would just, like lightning, come up and take a sailor.
And you were in the water for how long?
We bobbed up and down in that life preserver for 4.5 days and 5 nights. Finally, one afternoon, I heard a motor in the distance. That's whenever my hair stood straight up. Tears came in my eyes and chills came over me. That's the happiest day of my life.
Only 317 of nearly 1,200 men survived. Sadly, Arthur Michno, just 19 years old, is not among them.
That's one of the most amazing stories that I've ever heard.
I ask LD about the attack that occurred on the Indianapolis just months before the sinking.
Were you on the ship when the kamikaze attack took place at Okinawa?
Yeah, I sure was. I was having breakfast in the mess hall, and over the loudspeaker came a message, the word, man your battle stations. I got about midships, and I saw this plane or the shadow. I just got a glimpse as it was coming down, and all of a sudden I went up in the air.
The plane crashes through the ship's decks, flooding compartments, knocking two propellers off, and killing 9 men. The Indy is crippled. I ask LD if Arthur Michno's souvenirs could be from that attack.
I don't know about these, but now this piece of metal could easily have come off the deck. In fact, I picked up some debris, a piece of aluminum from the airplane wing.
LD tells me he brought his fragment home and later donated it to the museum. That's why he wanted to meet me here.
So that's your souvenir?
Yes, sir.
He says that the shattered Japanese plane was pushed into the water, but some debris remained on deck.
And this was one of the larger pieces still on deck, and I just picked it up and thought that'd be good keep.
And there were other guys out there picking souvenirs?
Well, at that time, we were pretty busy with trying to shoot down airplanes, but there was still quite a bit of smaller stuff, you know, laying around.
Even though the two medals don't look the same, maybe they came from different parts of the aircraft. I drop off a small sample of the two pieces at the University of Texas at Austin for a chemical analysis. My next stop is the U.S. Naval Intelligence Library in Washington, D.C.
Jack Green, Naval Historical Center.
Wes Cowan, how are you?
Hi, fine, thank you.
I'm meeting with historian Jack Green. He explains that in the spring of 1945, Okinawa was the focal point of U.S. military strategy in the Pacific.
The Battle of Okinawa is critical both to the Americans and the Japanese. Okinawa will be the spring-off point for the invasion of Japan, which was scheduled for the fall of 1945.
Okinawa is only 400 miles from Japan. The Imperial military knows that the more American ships they can sink, the more time they will have to prepare for the defense of the mainland. The Japanese send hundreds of kamikaze planes into the sky. It is a fight to the death for both sides. So how successful were the kamikaze pilots at Okinawa?
They were very successful. The Navy ends up losing 30 ships and 368 damaged by the conclusion of the battle.
I tell Jack that I'm trying to find out if there's any connection between Larry's artifacts and the kamikaze that hit the Indianapolis.
This I can't really help you with. You need to really talk to someone who's an expert on Japanese World War II aircraft. But these are Japanese Navy World War II.
My hunch was right. The anchors and chrysanthemum signified Japanese Imperial Navy. Jack shows me the official U.S. intelligence manual used to identify various ranks.
Now this one, because of the laurel wreath, tells us it's a petty officer. But the interesting thing is it's yellow. Now yellow was the seaman's branch. Now this is a seaman first class. Green is aviation maintenance.
Aviation branch, well that's interesting. That's potentially very important for us.
Yes it is.
Now is there any way to check to see what type of plane actually hit the Indianapolis that day? Next, Jack takes me to the Naval Archives to hunt for more specific information about the kamikaze that attacked the Indianapolis. The files are extensive. Finally, some luck. A press release has some key information. Listen to this. The Indianapolis was participating in the pre-invasion bombardment of Okinawa's beach defenses when she was attacked by a lone Jap, Oscar. What kind of a plane is an Oscar?
Well, during World War II, the Americans...
Jack explains that the Oscar was a single-seat Army fighter. But my two patches are both Navy.
So there's no way that those uniform patches could have come from a kamikaze pilot. That's right.
But what about the plaque and the chunk of metal?
Todd, Wes Cowan.
Todd Peterson is an expert in wartime Japanese aircraft.
Well, now that I have the piece in my hand, I notice that it's aluminum, and that strongly suggests that this was likely removed from an aircraft component.
The plaque lists the operating parameters for an engine part.
Basically, this is from an oil or fuel pressure regulator, and one of the lines here specifically says the operating parameters, 0.3 to 0.6.
He shows me a dial from a fuel pressure gauge that would have been used in a Japanese Army airplane. And he compares the parameters on both pieces.
And that happens to correspond with a Japanese Imperial Army instrument, which redlines at 0.6.
It's a fit. Todd thinks our piece may have come from a Japanese Army plane.
One thing I found out was that the kamikaze plane that crashed onto the Indianapolis was an Oscar. Could this plaque have come from a plane like that?
It could have. Based on the number range on the plate and how it matches up with the dial, it likely came from an Imperial Army aircraft.
But Todd also tells me that these types of plaques were often collected and traded among servicemen.
Anything that had Japanese lettering on it or from Japan from the combat theater was sent home.
I'm heading back to Texas to meet with chemist Jim Holcomb.
Hi, Wes. How you doing?
Who's been testing the two metal samples. Jim shows me a machine called an inductively coupled plasma time-of-flight mass spectrometer. The device heats a sample to 16,000 degrees Fahrenheit and turns it into tiny particles called ions. From there, Jim can determine what elements are present in each piece.
So, did you find out anything interesting?
Yeah, actually quite interesting. Let me take you over here and we'll show you the data.
What Jim has discovered is a little surprising, and I'm anxious to report back to Larry. First, I tell him about my visit with L.D. Cox and his memories of Arthur Michneau.
When I showed this photograph to L.D., he paused a second and he looked at him and he said, "You know, I recognize the face."
Wow. That was one of the things I was hoping to hear, that someone remembered him.
Then I tell him that the Navy patches are almost certainly not from the Army kamikaze plane. And although the metal plaque might be, what Jim Holcomb had discovered had put a different spin on Arthur Michneau's story.
Well, Wes, this is the mass spectrum for the piece from the museum. And as you might expect, we'll see a very substantial aluminum signal.
How does that compare with the aluminum from the other sample?
As you'll notice, the aluminum peak is actually quite small. The dominant peak that we're picking up is nickel, probably 90 to 95% pure nickel. Nickel essentially was considered in a short supply in Japan during this time. So to find such a high percentage nickel component on the plane, either the engine or its armament, would be very unlikely.
I tell Larry that we couldn't say exactly where the nickel had come from, but that it was entirely possible that none of these items came from the kamikaze attack.
It's very possible that all of these were merely souvenirs that were collected. So, what do you think?
Well, that's good to know. We really have very little to remember them by, so this kind of gives us just a little bit more information.
Larry, this was...
I also tell Larry how, in his uncle's final mission, delivering the atomic bomb to Tinian, Arthur Michneau and the crew of the Indy may have helped bring about an early end to the war in the Pacific.
They are part of a greater picture of the history of World War II, and your uncle was part of that story, and he was a real hero.
Oh, that's good to hear. More than I knew before.
To hear more of my interview with L.D. Cox and his amazing story of survival and the sinking of the USS Indianapolis, go to History Detectives on the web at pbs.org.
Planes rain down from the skies like locusts, crashing and exploding into heaps of twisted metal. What motivated these suicide pilots? And were they the reason behind President Truman's decision to drop the bombs? The term itself, kamikaze, means divine wind. Its origin traces back to 1281 when a massive typhoon destroyed Kublai Khan's fleet and his opportunity to invade Japan. The decision to launch kamikaze attacks only came in 1944 when Japan's defeat seemed imminent. Hundreds of young Japanese now made the ultimate sacrifice.
In the Battle of Okinawa, Japan launched its greatest barrage of kamikaze, striking nearly 200 U.S. ships and killing as many as 4,000 U.S. sailors. Some 1,400 suicide missions were flown in those final months leading up to the war's end.
Okinawa taught the U.S. military a painful lesson. Over 12,000 American servicemen died, and almost 150,000 civilians. President Truman was now faced with a terrible decision. The kamikaze had demonstrated Japan's will to defend the emperor. Invading the mainland would produce even more catastrophic loss of life. Ironically, the death toll at Okinawa was greater than all those killed during the atomic bombings.
Want to learn more about the investigations on History Detectives? Visit PBS.org and explore expanded case files, stories from people like you, and do-it-yourself guides.
Was made possible by contributions.